The House Speaker, Jose Oliva, joins us. How are you, sir?
I'm doing well. Thank you for having me this morning.
A belated happy birthday to you.
Thank you, sir. I'm a year older. I don't know about the wiser part, though.
Come on now. What does a birthday look like around the Oliva family?
Well, you know, typically it's your regular birthday with friends and cake and so forth. But because session starts next week, a birthday yesterday looked like briefings here in Tallahassee.
So what was the birthday briefings, Mr. Speaker?
Well, we were talking about a lot of the things that are coming up in this session. As you know, healthcare remains the central focus of our agenda, and that's not by our own doing. That's because it kind of chose us. In spite of all the positive economic indicators in Florida, healthcare continues to cripple families. And so that's what we've chosen as our main goal, is to try to inject some sort of free market principles into a very broken healthcare system. And so we continue to do that. And yesterday was a good amount of conversations about the scope of practice and making sure that people can practice to the extent of their training, and affordability and access. I mean, that continues to be our focus.
Florida House Speaker Jose Oliva with us this morning on the morning show. Mr. Speaker, how much autonomy does Florida have within the fractured nature of healthcare?
Well, when we've had autonomy, we've done a really good job. So the answer to your question is not as much as we should have. The truth is that states should have block grants from the federal government and then find their own solutions for their healthcare. In 2011, we passed a managed care system that basically said that we would have a capitated or per patient expenditure that we would make monthly, and then there would be organizations that would be required to provide healthcare, whatever healthcare is necessary, within that framework. Well, in those 8 years, that cost barely went up, and so we were able to keep the cost of healthcare in that Medicaid space among that population stable. In every other area where we've not had that kind of autonomy, healthcare prices have continued to balloon. And the simple reason is, as long as we have a system that does not put real checks on the healthcare institutions and basically allows them to charge whatever they want, whenever they want, without any justification whatsoever, and we keep pumping taxpayer dollars in their direction, they're going to continue to raise their prices. A bag of IV, which probably cost about $8 true cost, can be billed as high as $1,100 at a healthcare institution. Yeah.
Short
and
answer.
That's the beginning of it.
Well, short answer here, because we got to check for weather and traffic here in just a second. Is it possible to have true healthcare reform in the state or even nationally without dealing with tort reform?
I would say yes. Because okay. the main issue in healthcare, again, is the fact that the state keeps paying these exorbitant bills.
Government accountability, I know, is a pretty big deal for you. I'm quite certain, Jose, that the long FBI investigation into corruption in the city of Tallahassee, the recent announced investigation in Lynn Haven and other places in Florida, I've got to believe it's been on your radar to some extent. How much of that is being paid attention to by state lawmakers saying, hey, we need to learn from what's happening in these communities and do some things to put some accountability, some ethical standards in place that put us beyond reproach?
Well, a good deal of it is on our radar. In fact, as you know, one of our most storied institutions, Moffitt Cancer Center, recently had an issue where the CEO of the cancer center had some dealings with Chinese institutions, and intellectual property and the theft of that intellectual property is a major area of concern. And that's why we've set up the select committee that'll be chaired by the speaker-designate Chris Sprouls to make sure that all of our institutions that are taxpayer-funded are protected against this kind of intellectual theft.
Chris Sprouls comes up in a lot of things. He's the speaker-designate, as you mentioned, and I wanted to just get your feelings on this. He made comments when he was named as the designate speaker and others in state governance have made statements that seem to be opening the door for the GOP to be embracing some of the global warming fanaticism that's out there. Mr. Speaker, are you concerned at all about kind of the direction that we're going? I know that Governor DeSantis is wildly popular. He's done a lot of great things. But the sustainability office and just some of this stuff just seems to be a little beyond the pale for me.
Well, I think that what the speaker-designate was trying to say is that the facts matter and that he is open to looking at the facts. And I think that that's always been the case. You know, in South Florida, there's a lot of talk about sea level rise. Well, you know, we have funded studies to show, is there sea level rise or is Miami Beach having a problem with their original fill and being overbuilt? And that's what's causing some of the flooding down there, because right across the bay, Key Biscayne is not suffering from the same kind of flooding.
Right.
And we all know the old adage, a rising tide lifts all boats. Well, a rising tide should flood all streets, if that's the case. And so, you know, I think that as Republicans, what we're trying to say is, listen, we are not deniers. What we are looking for is the real facts. We're not getting caught up in the fanaticism of it. We're trying to find the facts. And wherever, usually as conservatives, wherever facts lead us, is that's where we go. So I think that's what he was trying to put an emphasis on and remove the stigma that Republicans are not for conservation. The truth is that the cleanest air in the nation is not in California. It's in Florida.
I've been asking listeners this morning to consider what they think the 2020 headlines will be for the year. If I were to ask you, what are the big takeaways going to be from the legislative session? What would those headlines be in your estimation?
Well, I hope that it will continue to be fiscal responsibility. The bottom line is, and I don't know why more is not made of this. There are 50 states. Each of them have their own legislature. And while the federal government really has imposed too much authority over the states, each of those states still determines their economic well-being. What can be seen clearly throughout the nation is that those states that hold true to conservative principles, mm-hmm. that are fiscally sound states, are doing very well. Other states, equal-sized populations, good industries within the states, those that haven't lost them. States like Illinois, New Jersey, New York, they're hemorrhaging people. They're having, California, of course, they're having a difficult time with their economy. We have to be able to connect the dots. The reason they're having a hard time is because their economic policies are about not controlling spending, but seeing how they can generate more revenue. And there's only so much that you can take from people before you really start to weaken your economy.
You've got a lot of state workers listening to you right now, Mr. Speaker. What would you have them know, given that it seems as though a lot of the headlines in the newspapers are that the state workers are getting stiffed and not getting raises?
Well, I think that we have to, again, like with all things, we have to look at the facts. And if you look at the facts, you'll see that the state government has been supportive of state workers statewide. Now, everything that we do, we have to do within our means. Fortunately, we have a balanced budget state, and that means that we cannot spend dollars that we do not bring in. And so everything that we do, we must do within the confines of that. And I think throughout the years, we've tried to show that we're trying to spend responsibly so that we have additional dollars so that we can support our state workers and our teachers and our school system. But we must do it within our means. You know, oftentimes, and you see this again in other states that we talked about, you know, spending doesn't mean caring. Spending just means that you're creating obligations for the entire population and you're putting a burden upon the state. And so what we've done is that we spend responsibly. That's why we were able to emerge from a recession quicker than other states. That's why we're sitting in a fiscal position that is the envy of the nation. So everything that we do, we must do within that prism.
You know, it's interesting because I come with a very different view than many. And even though we're obviously based in an area that is flooded with state workers, they don't always like me when I talk about this. But, Mr. Speaker, I'm with you on this issue 100%. I'm of the opinion that, you know, state jobs should have a cap. There shouldn't be COLAs. all the time. And in fact, you know, there's just a limit to what that job pays. And if you want to make more, go to the private sector or acquire skills and get a better job inside the state that pays more. Otherwise, the taxpayers are going to continuously end up losing more and more of their money.
Well, and we also have to make sure that we're targeting increases to ensure that they are being used where they need to. So in the area of corrections, this is an area that this year we're looking to have a notable increase.
Yes.
Because it's important and it's needed. In the area of child welfare, you know, these people that actually go out and go into homes and make decisions whether those children stay in homes or not, you know, they're overburdened at this point. They need additional help. And so we have to look at all of these different areas, not to mention all of the other costs. And what I always try to tell folks is if you take one issue at a time, and then you determine how much the legislature cares about you by how much money they poured on that, you will end up being California, New York, Connecticut, and Illinois. If you understand that we have to look at these things holistically, and we have to figure this is the amount of money we've got, this is how we should divide it out, then you'd probably understand why, as conservatives, we fight for less spending in all areas, not in any one single area, but in all areas. Because when you're fiscally sound, you have the capacity to make increases when you have to make them.
We've got Commissioner Richard Corcoran scheduled to come on the show sometime this month, so I'll save the education stuff for the commissioner. But I do want to talk about one thing that has been pushed out by the governor, and I hope there's going to be a robust debate about this, Mr. Speaker, and that's the discussion on paying athletes inside the state university system. I totally disagree with the governor on this. I think California was wrong. But at the same time, what are your thoughts? What's your disposition on the issue?
Well, if I could be as brief as possible, here's what I would say. I don't think you would disagree with the fact that there ought to be a quality of treatment of athletes. And so, let me explain quickly what I mean. If I'm a swimmer at a university, and I go to the Olympics and I win a gold medal, I can receive a check for doing that. I can have a YouTube channel. I can enter into all sorts of income generating activities. But if I'm a football player, I can't do that. Why is there a different treatment for different people? I think what you're talking about is should a football or basketball player get a direct check, and won't that become professional sports? I would agree with you. But that's not what we're arguing, and we're not arguing what California argues. What we're arguing, and obviously I'm in support of some sort of reform here, is that the football player should be treated the same as the swimmer, the same as the pole vaulter. Why does the football player have greater restrictions upon them? And here's another thing that I'll say. The college system, as much as we all love it, has kind of brought this upon themselves.
No doubt.
Because college sports began as if you went to that school and you were good at the sport, you could play, and you know, people would come in the paneled station wagon and have picnics and watch the football game, and that was it. And now it's basically become pro sports. It is of a magnitude that is tremendous. So those rains brought these floods, is what I would say. They've kind of brought it on themselves by really becoming semi-pro sports. But having said all that, the discussion we're having in Florida is about treating all student athletes the same and making sure that we are not restricting one group of athletes because they're more valuable and their activity is more valuable than another's. I don't think that any conservative would be in support of that.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much for your time. Hopefully we'll speak again when the session concludes. Thanks so much.
Thank you, and thank you for having me on the show.